going to look at how to use power series to solve some ordinary differential equations. You might be like, but I already know how to solve this, because see, you go r squared plus 1, because you write the characteristic equation, so that means r is equal to plus or minus I, which means my solution is c1 cosine x plus c2 sine x. Done. Thank you. End of video. But no. Let's pretend that we want to solve this, but we want to like really, really impress our friends. So like maybe we're on a date and it's not going well. And we're like, okay, wait, before you go, let me show you how I can use a power series to solve this second order ODE. And they'll be like, whoa, seriously? And you'll be like, yeah, check it out. Okay, so this is how you would do it. So you say, well, I'm going to start off with something that looks like this. I'm going to start off with y is equal to n equals 0 to infinity, a sub n, and then x to the n. And they're like, and check this out. Okay, so look, I'm going to differentiate it. And because I'm really good at this now, because I go n equals 1 to infinity. And they're like, how come you're starting at 1? You're like, because there's infinitely or one less than infinity terms now, so shut up. And then you go, like this. And then I can double differentiate. And then I start n equals 2 to infinity. And then that's n minus 1 times n, a n, x, n minus 2. And you're like, yay, now look at, like this, equals 0. So I'm actually just going to plug these in. So I've got n equals 2 to infinity. So n minus 1, n, a to the n, x, n minus 2. And then plus, so that's this guy, which I got from here. And then I'm going to do this guy, which I'm going to get from here. And that's just straight up. N equals 0 to infinity, a, n, x to the n. And I know that's equal to 0. And you're like, so, look. So, because I'm super awesome, I'm going to add 2 here, add 2 here, add 2 here, add 2 here, and subtract 2 here. How come you're not subtracting from infinity? Because infinity minus blah, blah, blah. You just said, I know, just stop talking. Because I'm going to do this, n plus 1. And then n plus 2, a sub n plus 2, x to the n plus this. Now what's awesome about this is because everything's now in terms of the coefficient of x to the n, so I can actually combine these and get n equals 0 to infinity of n plus 1, n plus 2, a n plus 2 plus a n times x to the n equals 0. Now what's amazing about this is I can actually come in and say that if I was going to write this out, so like I don't even want to, but let's pretend I have to. So if I plug in n equals 0, I would get 2a2 plus a naught x to the first plus what is that? What is 1 plus 1 is 2. Well, yes, okay, I'll just do it that way. Plus 2 times 3, a 3, plus a to the first, x to the first. There we go. I'm just plugging stuff in. And then stuff x squared plus et cetera, et cetera, equals 0. Now, we might say, the only way that all of that can be equal to 0 is if each individual coefficient on its own is equal to 0. And you'd be like, well, but wait a second, because what if one coefficient is minus 2 and the next one is plus 2? But the first one is minus 2 regular, the next one is plus 2x. So even if you do something like that, you still have this extra x. So the only way that it can work is if every single coefficient is 2, or sorry, if every single coefficient is 0. So it's basically like the method of undetermined coefficients, where I'm matching that each one of these terms has to match, and so it has to be 0. So basically what I'm able to do is I'm able to say that this whole coefficient here, which is n plus 1 times n plus 2 times a sub n plus 2 plus a n has to equal 0 because I said so. Well, not because I said so, but because we're matching coefficients and those coefficients have to be 0. So that tells me that a sub n is equal to something minus a n plus 2 times, or wait, what am I doing? I'm confused. Wait, let me do it the other way. Let me solve for a n plus 2, that's what I meant to do, is equal to negative a over n divided by n plus 1 and n plus 2. Okay, So now we're going to do something that's just phenomenally obnoxious. Like you could not be more obnoxious than this. And don't freak out because you don't have to do this every time. But it's really important for pedagogical purposes. So let's say that we have n is equal to 0. Okay? Now if we have n equals 0, that means I have a sub 2 is equal to negative a sub naught over 1 times 2. Good? So, wonderful. Now, and I'm going to make these in a column, but I'm going to separate them out like this, and you'll know why in a little bit. So, if n equals 1, I have a sub 3 is equal to negative a sub 1 over 2 times 3. Okay, then I have n equals 2, which would give me a sub 4 is equal to negative a sub 2 over 3 times 4, but I know that a sub 2 is that, so that tells me that I've got negative a sub naught over 1 times 2, negative that, divided by 3 times 4. Negative times a negative is a positive, so I have a naught, and I'm just going to write that as 4 factorial. Alrighty, and I'll do some more. Now I say that n equals 3. So go ahead and see if you can come up with n equals 3 on your own. Pause the video, see how far you can get. So this is going to be a sub 5 is negative a sub 3 times 4 times 5. But I know that a sub 3 is this guy. So I've got negative a sub 1 over 2 times 3. So I've got negative a 3 divided by 4 times 5. So that gives me negative times negative is positive. A1, 5, factorial. Kind of fun? Ooh, where'd you go? There you are. All right. So if I keep doing this, essentially what I'm going to get is that A6 is equal to A0, negative A0 over 6 factorial, and then A8 is going to be equal to positive A0 over 8 factorial. And then a7 is going to be equal to negative a1 over 7 factorial, and a9 is going to be equal to positive a1 over 9 factorial. You're like, why do I care? Okay, I'll tell you why. Basically, what's going on is that every time something is even, that we're going to end up with an alternate. For the even sides, we've got a pattern, and for the odd sides, we've got a pattern. Okay, so what we're going to do is we're going to try to incorporate this into something. So from over here, what we can do is we're going to let something be like m, starting at 0, and go 1, 2, 3, etc. So for m, starting at 0 and going forever, we could say that a sub 2m is equal to, and this is going to be a little weird, so bear with me. So we can say that a sub 2m would alternate in sign, so we do negative 1 to the m, because that will give me plus, minus, it starts off with a minus, which is what we want. Well, actually, if it starts off with a, when we put in zero, it comes out to be positive. But hold on, I'll show you this is okay in just a second. And then it's gonna be a naught, and then it's gonna be 2m factorial, because the thing on the bottom is 2 factorial, 4, 6, 8 factorial. So this way, we have that flippy floppy on the positive negative, and then the two, the positive number in the factorial. Now, so whenever m equals 0, that gives us a sub 0 is equal to negative 1 to the 0, which is just a 1, times a naught over 0 factorial, which is just a naught. So that gives us a naught is a naught. And then if we say m equals 1, that's 1 or 2 times 1 is 2, negative 1 to the 1, a naught. And then again, 2 factorial. So that gives us negative a naught over 2, which is what we got. So if I keep going, I'm going to confirm that this here is going to express that coefficient. Now similarly on this side, if I again let m going from 0, 1, 2, 3, etc., I can say now I only want the odd numbers. So I can describe that as a to the 2m plus 1, like that. And then I can say that that's negative 1 to the m, because that's going to give me the flip-flop on the signs. A1, and in the bottom, since I only have odd numbers and I'm taking the factorial for, it'd be 2m plus 1 factorial, like that. And again, if you plug these in, you're going to get the exact same thing. So basically, I can use this here to establish my other coefficients, which is, again, like we said, phenomenally obnoxious, but, you know, that's the whole point. We're doing math to impress people. All right, so remember that I had somewhere long time ago, I had that my solution was the summation of n equals 0 to infinity an xn. That's where all this came from, is my initial proposal that I thought the solution was in this format. Okay, so basically what we're going to do is we currently have 0 to infinity. We have an infinite number of terms. I'm going to rewrite this as an infinite number of terms, except I'm going to only do half as many infinite terms, but I'm going to have twice as, I'm only going to do half the number of summations, but I'm going to have twice as many terms. So I'm going to say am xm, and then let's do it actually this way, a sub 2m to the 2m, and then plus a 2m plus 1 x 2m plus 1. So essentially, if I plug in 0, I get terms 1 and 2, or 0 and 1. So if I plug in m equals, you can't see what I'm doing. So if I plug in m equals 0, I get terms 0 and 1. If I plug in m equals 1, then I get 2 and 3. M equals 2 gives me 4 and 5, and so on and so forth. So I still have the exact same terms. I've just written them differently, and of course the reason I'm writing them differently is so that I can plug in these new lovely little terms that I came up with. So I now have y is equal, m equals 0 to infinity, a sub 2m we decided was negative 1 to the m a naught over 2m factorial. Now, is this something I expect you to be able to do, like, on your own, just be like, oh, I figured this out. I don't know, maybe, probably not. I wouldn't have figured this out on my own. I looked at a book, and then it took me like 3 hours to figure out what the book was doing. And then I made a video, so maybe other people wouldn't have to learn how to read, because it's completely unnecessary. You can just watch videos to learn stuff. Doop-de-doop-de-do. All right. So what I'm going to do now is I'm actually going to split these out into two different summations. These are constants, so I can pull them out in front of the summations, and I'm going to do that as well. So a naught m equals 0 to infinity, and there should be like some little part of your soul that's starting to get excited. Maybe the phenomenally obnoxious part of your soul that's only doing this to impress people. All right, so check this out. You'd be like, this is stupid. I don't know what I'm supposed to be noticing here. But no, seriously, you're supposed to be noticing something. This right here should possibly, like make some little part of your brain go, wait a second, I've seen this before. Or maybe this one. You'd be like, wait, I know I've seen this before, I'm not sure where. So take a minute and think about it and see if you can remember where you have seen it. And maybe somewhere in the depths of your brain, you will somehow recall that this would be the Taylor series, does that help? For, do you know what this Taylor series for? This is the Taylor series for cosine. And this is the Taylor series for sine. And if you have no idea what a Taylor series is, you definitely want to go look that up. It's a really neat little trick that you can use to approximate functions. This is the Taylor series for cosine, and the other is the Taylor series for sine, which basically means that I can substitute that in. This here is 100% fundamentally equivalent to a naught cosine x, and then the other one is fundamentally equivalent to a1 sine of x, which, if you will notice, is precisely what we had like 10 minutes ago, way long ago, somewhere. I don't even know where it went anymore. Here it was. That's the same thing we got 10 minutes ago, but look, we did it with summations. All right, why do we go through all of this? Well, because basically the idea is we're mostly doing this to prove that, not even prove, but just to demonstrate that this strategy works. And you're like, but that's really stupid, because if I have this, I can just solve it using methods I already know, and I don't have to go through all these problems, which is all well and good. And in fact, even if I gave you something like this, or even if I gave you something like this, you could still solve that using methods that you already have. Now, the problem comes in is if I simply replace that 3 with a 3x. Now, every method that you know gets thrown out the window and we can't solve it anymore. And that's how these power series are going to come in. So this is just an example to kind of demonstrate how this is going to look potentially in the future, so that you have a little bit of confidence that, okay, this is actually going to work.